My name is Seek Donnelly. I've been a nerd my entire life. I've been working since I was 15 years old, everything from retail to movie production to comic books. I've been in and out of hospitals more times than I care to count, but I've been lucky enough to make some amazing friends and meet some amazing people. And now I want to share some of those experiences with you. Welcome to my life.
I just need to hold the roof up. I'm counting lines in the ceiling now. I count cracks in the ceiling now. As my window shook in 87.
Everyone, so it's raining out. I wanted to shoot this video really quick to show my excitement. I got my discharge paperwork, so I actually don't have to come back here anymore. I can just keep doing my stretches at home and keep my back in check that way. So this is awesome because honestly, on my days off driving over here, it's been like, oh, I just want to go home. I just want to stay home with my dog and play video games and do that kind of stuff. So now that I have my free days, 100% free now, I can do things that I want to do. Maybe sign up for a gym membership, actually, so I can stay active and stay healthy. So there's going to be some changes that I got to make. Obviously, I'm getting older. I'm going to be 40 in a couple years, so I got to stay on top of this stuff. I may be young at heart, but my body is old man Logan. It's falling apart on me. But I appreciate all the support, everything that you guys have said, and as I've been sick and everything, and getting better and healing, I appreciate your patience with my videos. Allowing me the time to heal and not unsubscribing. That means a lot to me. So I promise more videos soon, including this one that's already up now. So let's go find our Fight Club stuff. Let's talk a little bit about Fight Club. Kind of my memories of it while we're driving over there, driving home. We're gonna have a fun time. So hopefully you guys enjoy this video.
Taking all that shit and mix it up. I was taking all that shit and mix it up. Since that first pretty girl ran her fingers through my hair. Since that first pretty girl ran her fingers through my hair.
I just got out of Golden Apple Comics and I have my Fight Club issues here. I have issue one of Fight Club number 3. So basically there's Fight Club 1, the novel, obviously. And then there was Fight Club 2, which I have the graphic novel here. We're gonna look at it in a second. But then series 3 just came out, Fight Club 3. And I guess there's a reason why Chuck Palahniuk called this Fight Club 2 and Fight Club 3 and not Project Mayhem and all that stuff. So that was one of the questions my friend Alex, way back at Comic-Con when Fight Club 2 came out. I was in Artist Alley signing, and he came over to me and said, dude, I scored an interview with Chuck Palahniuk for Fight Club 2. What should I add? I'm running out of questions. I only came up with so many questions. Could you give me an idea for one or two other ones? And I said, hey, yeah, ask him why it's called Fight Club 2 and not Project Mayhem. And apparently he's like, hey, I can't spoil that, but that's in the book. You're going to see why exactly. So I've only read Fight Club 2 issue 1, but this is the whole collection of all the issues. So I'm really looking forward to reading this all in one sitting finally, and then also to see where the story goes from there. And so you see here, Chuck signed it. Thank you, Ryan, again at Golden Apple. Thank you so much, Golden Apple Comics. 40 years, you saw their banner and their signs and the footage that I shot, 40 years in business. And that's saying a lot. I mean, they've done so much, for me. Giving me a job at one point, taking care of me, being my comic book, my go-to comic store here in LA for, 12 years now since I moved out here in 2007. Even though I went back home for a year, you know, to heal and stuff. But still, I mean, they've been around, you know, been part of my family, and they're like my second family. So I love them to pieces, and it was so nice of them to do this. So they got number one signed for me, and then I went ahead and picked up issue two, because I guess that came out, and there might even be an issue three out now. I don't know, but I didn't see it in there, but I'll pick it up at some point. I just didn't have a ton of time to look around too much. But this was really nice, you know, Ryan, you know, put my name on it so that Chuck knew how to spell my name. I'm guessing because my name gets misspelled a ton, as you can imagine. And the Fight Club 2, The Tranquility Gambit. And you get a nice introduction here from Gerald Howard from October 2015. But then you also get this signed to me, to Seek, in Tyler He Trusted. And then he wrote a little arrow, Silly Seek. That's awesome. You know, this movie and the book, when it came out, were really impactful on me as a young man. And we'll talk about that on my drive home. I don't want to film too much while I'm driving, though, because I did last time, but that was easy because there was no traffic, no cars around. Now it's rainy and it's nasty out, and cars are kind of psychotic in the rain out here in California. So we'll probably just cut to me back home, and we'll talk more, you know, when we get there and look at this stuff, and we'll talk more about Fight Club and kind of my first impressions of it. And now my impressions currently as an older, you know, 37-year-old who has rewatched it recently, you know, what it means to me now. So let's, you know, cut home and let's dive into that. All right, so I'm back home. I got my Fight Club books. I got Fight Club 2 right behind me there with that beautiful David Mack cover. It looks so awesome. And then I got issues 1 and 2 of Series 3, of Fight Club 3. So, you know, I've read some of Fight Club 2, basically the premise. Actually, let's talk about the movie first, because the movie came out in 1999, but I think the book was originally written as like this short story. And I forget the guy's name, so I'm going to look it up here in the book. There was an editor that worked on the novel, and his name is Gerald Howard, and he wrote this in October of 2015. He did the intro of this book, and I was reading that, and I thought it was pretty interesting, because he was a guy who was working for a publisher at the time, and came across a different book called Invisible Monsters that Chuck Palahniuk wrote. And he even mentioned that it was hard to pronounce his name, because when he saw it on paper, he's like, I don't know how to pronounce that. And he actually said, I read the book, I liked it. And then sometime later, we stayed in touch, we stayed as friends. I tried to get his book published. Things were moving around, and then he came up with this idea for Fight Club about a group of guys who worked in an office, kind of like Office Space style, who were tired of getting picked on, tired of getting mistreated or ignored or whatever, and they just felt invisible in their lives. And so what they end up doing is going out on the weekends to a bar and getting into fights, and then coming back and, you know, coming to work with like bruises and stuff. And after that, people at work stopped messing with them. And that was like the initial premise, I guess, of this short story of Fight Club. And Gerald was like, hey, are you going to turn this into a full novel? And Chuck Palahniuk was like, yeah, I think I can. So he went away and took some time, wrote it, came back, you know, pitched it, and he thought it was awesome. You know, Gerald was like, this was a really good book. I really liked the premise. There were some changes he talked about that they made to the book that made him kind of happy. As an editor, he was like, yeah, I don't know if this will sell that well or this will push the envelope a little too much. And they cut some things back, but they ultimately, you know, found a nice compromise and came up with a really great story that they both believed in, both from the publisher standpoint and as an editor, and then also Chuck Palahniuk as the creative force behind the book. And so hearing that and seeing that kind of thing going, that's really great. It's very important in creative endeavors. It's almost like a real relationship. There is compromise. There are times where you have to settle in a way and you have to come to a middle ground. And then a lot of times when you come to that, it's for the best, right? It can be the best solution. And it takes hard work, you know, to work at things like that. So it was cool to see kind of his point of view of how Fight Club came to life, and then how it became a movie through Laura Ziskin, who worked at Fox, you know, took some interest in the property and thought it would make a great movie. And then Brad Pitt got involved, Edward Norton, the great writer that worked on the movie, who I'm blanking on his name right now, so I'm just going to pull it up right here. And then obviously you had Dave Fincher, who directed it, which is really great. And they had a great team. Jim Ulls, who wrote the script, the screenplay for the movie. And then Dave Fincher came on to direct it. And Fight Club, when it came out in 1999, I remember it got pushed back because of Columbine, I believe, because I was in high school at the time. Columbine happened. I used to dress in black, used to wear trench coats, and because I was like kind of a goth kind of kid. And I remember Columbine happened, and it changed. They told us we could not dress that way anymore at school. People turned and looked at me differently. They were afraid of me. Before, they made fun of me. Then all of a sudden, everybody was afraid of me. And obviously, I didn't want that. I didn't want to be feared by people. I'm not Batman, you know, and they're not criminals. I just wanted to get through high school with making, you know, the least amount of punches on my face as possible. And but I was a kid who grew up fighting a lot, and I was trying to not fight. There was even a time, I think, in 10th or 11th grade where a guy thought I was hitting on his girlfriend, and he came to fight me, and I got mad. The old me came out and wanted to fight him, and then in the middle of the fight, I just was like, I'm not doing it. So all I did was I just prevented him from punching me, and I was like, I'm not going to punch him back. I'm just going to prevent him from punching me. And I remember that was like a turning point in my life, and as far as like how I perceived violence and how I wanted to, you know, project violence at, you know, and if I wanted to anymore. And then Fight Club came out not too long after. They pushed it back after Columbine, and then the movie came out, and I went, saw it in the theaters because I thought it looked very interesting. And I think the Dust Brothers, I think, did the score, or the, yeah, I think they did the score to the movie, who I really loved at the time. I loved their work. And I, Dave Fincher, I was, you know, really drawn to like the style of the trailer and everything. And, but the movie did not do well in the theaters. It pretty much died in the theaters and went to home video. And at that time I got a job at Blockbuster Video when it came out on VHS and DVD later on. And I was hooked. I watched that movie a ton because I thought what it represented at the time was this me as someone who didn't really want to fight anymore, who was suppressing this, this, you know, anger I grew up with, you know, abusive dad, broken home to a certain extent, which became a good home later after my parents divorced. But I felt there was two sides of me, and there was a beast that wanted to come out sometimes, sometimes for the wrong reasons, sometimes for the right reasons. And then there was the me who was just trying to, you know, fit in and just not make waves and just do my, you know, go work a job, go to school, do my work, do what's expected of me, and, you know, and just be invisible. I kind of liked that part of me like that. And then there was the side that didn't, the side that wanted to be noticed and that was making a fuss. And I'm not saying I had split personality or anything, but I just felt that way. I felt that, you know, dichotomy inside of me, that friction. And this movie was an interesting look into like the worst case scenario of that, of having these two sides not getting along or even befriending each other and it going really south. That's what I took away from it. And then now, you know, and that movie, it didn't represent, I know a lot of people are like, oh, it's mass, you know, it's a horrible male toxicity and, you know, and all that stuff and bad masculinity and all that. And I never really took that away from it. I took it away as a life, like a life lesson, like, you know, sometimes doing the mundane is fine. You're meant to do that. Because when you give into the other side of you that's saying, no, we got to do something great or bigger, it could lead to chaos. It could lead to Project Mayhem. It could lead to something way worse than just what Fight Club started out as. And it was this escalation, and things kept escalating in his life and kept getting worse and worse and worse. And this guy who was just trying to do, just be normal and get through and just didn't want to be messed with and just wanted to be invisible and get by and do things and have his little apartment the way he wanted. I mean, this was all like me in my 20s. I wanted like certain things on my wall a certain way. I still have that OCD with what I hang on my wall. And you find these things that you see yourself in these forms of artwork. That's what Fight Club was to me. It was like this kind of this mirror of how bad things could get if I didn't find a way to be both, you know, and otherwise, you know, this could happen. Obviously it's very fictitious, but it kind of showed me the worst case scenario of how dueling sides of yourself, if you don't find that compromise, you won't survive it, or other people won't survive it, and that was kind of what Fight Club was a representative to me. All the other stuff was just kind of cool and neat, and you know, it was like this boys club thing, which you know guys tend to do sometimes, but it grew into Project Mayhem, it grew into other things, and it evolved like a lot of things do. But then to see that ending where, you know, they play Where Is My Mind, you know, everything's crumbling, all the buildings are crumbling, and you don't really know what side of Tyler Durden is left. I mean, you kind of get a glimpse that maybe it's the Edward Norton side of him and not the Brad Pitt side, because it's actually Edward Norton physically there and not Brad Pitt there. But you still like, was the bullet through the mouth the compromise? Did it bring the two together, or did it shut one out completely? Did it completely kill Tyler. And that's where Fight Club 2 comes in. So it's neat as like a 37-year-old now going back and revisiting this. I just watched the movie again probably about a month ago because I was anticipating on going to this signing. And then unfortunately, I got really sick. I was in the hospital, so I couldn't even go to work that weekend, let alone go to a fun, you know, comic book signing like this. So it was really nice of Ryan to do this and to get Fight Club 3 signed for me and to get a nice little message in here from Chuck Palahniuk to me, which is awesome. Fight Club 2 is kind of, Tyler, he's not Tyler anymore. He goes by the name Sebastian, and he's married to Marla. They got married and they have a son. And basically Marla is bored. She does not like how boring Sebastian is. Apparently he's on a lot of meds. He went to a nut house after, their words, you know, that he went to get, you know, psychiatric help, after the events of the first movie, apparently. And now they're like in their mid 30s. And Marla's like, you know, I have to dye my hair and I have to like do this to like look good. And I just want someone to have sex with me for who I am, you know. And she's telling this to a focus or like a group of people who have like an aging ailment where they're like age, like, almost like not Benjamin Button like, but they kind of age differently. And she's like venting her problems to them. They are like, well, their problems are clearly way worse than hers. She's just like become this bored housewife, and she wants the crazy guy back. She realized after all these years of having a kid with Sebastian and living a normal life that she doesn't want this at all. It's not what she wants. So she has been trading out his actual medication for aspirin. And she's been like exchanging with aspirin. So he's not actually taking anything that's helping him and suppressing Tyler. And so that's what's happening, is Tyler's slowly creeping back in his life because of it. And she's thinking, well, what's the worst that could happen? I don't think anything bad could really come from this. And what ends up happening is that Tyler slowly sneaking out, and he's like, when the psychiatrist is hypnotizing Sebastian to talk to him and to break through to him, he's actually doing that on purpose to let Tyler out so Tyler could plan more Fight Club things and more Project Mayhem things and all this other stuff that's going on. And turns out, people are still won't let, you know, Sebastian pay for meals when he goes to a restaurant or a bar. They won't let him pay for stuff. They won't let him pay for gas. They're like, no, you don't get charged, sir. You know, like they still treat him like Tyler because they're waiting for Tyler to come back out because they know he's been slipping lately because of the aspirin and stuff. So now Tyler's out, and he even admits to Sebastian, the first one, in the first issue, he says, like, I'm going to take you out the way I took our father out. And that's interesting to me. That's new to me. That was new information. I remember reading the book way back when. I saw the movie first, obviously, and then I went and read the book. But I only read the book one time, so it's not really fresh in my mind. The movie I've seen like 50 times, so that's way more fresh in my mind. And I remember him mentioning that, you know, his father, and he had this line where he said, you know, we're a generation of men raised by women. I'm wondering if another woman is what we really need in our life. So Tyler never really had this thing for Marla. It was this, he did it, I guess, in a way to find a compromise with the narrator or Edward Norton or Sebastian in this case. And so he always did it, I think, as a compromise, or at least that's what it came across to me. But now that Tyler, you know, he's at Sebastian's married to Marla and they have this life and this son, he's got to like, I got to take it away. I got to take it away from him because he didn't deserve a happy ending for shooting me in the mouth and getting rid of me and suppressing me all these years with these pills. So Tyler's back with a vengeance. So I haven't read past that. So I'm very much looking forward to reading the rest of this. I only had issue one of Fight Club 2 when it came out, and I read that, and I loved it. I thought it was great. But I haven't read beyond that. Or maybe I read the first two issues, but I haven't read beyond that. So I'm really looking forward to sitting down and reading this and checking it out so that I can be caught up and I can dive into Fight Club 3. But I just wanted to make this little video for you guys so you guys know that if you are a Fight Club fan, there are other Fight Club stories out there. And it's really neat. I think in today's day and age, it's a really neat time period for a character like Tyler Durden to pop back up in with everything that's going on in the world. And they do kind of address that in this book, but without being like preachy or anything, at least the stuff I've read so far. I don't know how it ends, so we'll see, but I'm very excited to read it. But I want to hear from you. Like, what was your takeaway from Fight Club? Did it make you go to the gym? Did it make you tougher? Did it bring out like a testosterone side of you? Or did it do what kind of did to me, where it made me look at the two sides of the coin that's inside me and find a way to balance it? That's kind of what my takeaway from that movie was balance. It gave me like a a Zen-like approach to things. And after that, I remember reading stuff like Sun Tzu and The Art of War, and I remember reading different yoga rituals and getting into spirituality and stuff like that from a learning standpoint, not from like a practicing standpoint, but just from a learning standpoint of how to balance these the angel and demon on our shoulders. And so that was my takeaway from the story, but maybe you guys have something different. So if so, whether it's negative or positive, let me know down in the comments below. Have you read Fight Club 2? Do you like it? Have you read 3? If you read Fight Club 3, let me know what you think of that. I'm going to dive into that as soon as I finish 2. But I thank you for watching this episode, this quick little vlog of me going to the comic store and just picking up these issues. Thank you, Ryan, again at Golden Apple for everything. And thank you, US Health Works. I forgot to mention you guys earlier, again, to thank you when I was leaving your facilities. Thank you for, Bobby and everyone who helped me, Dan, who helped me, get back on my feet, literally, my back helping me reduce my pain, helping me, showing me different techniques of posture and things that I could work on, stretches I need to do. Thank you guys for getting me back on my feet and my life back on track so I can go to work and not be in pain and work through and do it with a smile on my face instead of, gritting my teeth. This last week back at work has been amazing, and I owe that to the help that I got over there. So thank you guys very much. And then also thank you, Ryan, for taking care of me while I was sick and hooking me up with these things and saving these for me so I could pick them up today and buy them from you guys. And they were signed and personalized to me from Chuck Palahniuk, a writer who I greatly admire. So thank you again. And everyone else, thank you so much for watching. Like, share, subscribe, all that fun stuff. I have more videos coming up very soon. Thank you. Peace.